because it's money in there.
Right.
It's still race and crack white.
That's right.
You think white ain't nothing no good. White rice ain't good for you. White rice, you can kill you. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Huh? When rice first made, it ain't white. It's brown. When they get through bleaching and go through all them changes and that, it come out, ain't nothing left in there but it's poison. Just like sugar. How y'all like sugar? Huh? Y'all put it down. Because white sugar is dangerous.
Yes, it is.
I went off down somewhere. Sugar's not really white. It's bleached white. Processed. And what you get is a chemical. Sugar is a drug. Honey, if you go into a diabetic something, they give you sugar. But then you're a sugar diabetic. They call it diabetes, that's why I call it diabetic. But it takes sugar what? To calm you down. Sugar makes some kids very active. So you can't get into certain things. Cause it's real hype. It's a drug. I got all these books laid out. I ain't make the hat with these jokes tonight. But let's move along. One author says that mental bondage is invisible bondage.
Yes.
Former and physical slavery has ended in the United States, but mental slavery continues to this day. So we talk about the white man, but we do it to ourselves.
Uh-huh.
He might have imposed this idea, but we're the one that perpetuates it.
Yeah.
You follow what I'm saying? Not only that, he says, this slavery affects the mind of all people in one way or another. This is worse than physical slavery alone. That is, the person who is mentally in bondage will self-contain.
All
right. That's why I have a lot of time with black folks. See, white don't bother me, it's black folks that bother me.
All
right. Come on. Leave it, don't leave it alone. You shouldn't do that enough. Yeah. Won't support nothing. Not only will that person fail to challenge beliefs and paths of thought which control him, he will defend and protect those beliefs and paths of thought with his very last dying breath.
Yeah.
Are y'all with me?
Uh-huh.
That is a quote that I want to read from the book called Spirits Call My Back. It says to this fat kid, the master's tool will never dismount the master's house. It may allow us to temporarily beat him at his game, but it never bring about genuine change. You can't beat a man with his own game. You must devise a plan of your own that will counteract or counterbalance his thing. Peanut shell game. You with me?
Yeah.
You see, we have to realize that we have been victimized. And that we are only playing a role in this play of the scheme that has been set up as people play with our lives. Y'all follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You are taught, don't try to create no job. You're always working somebody else.
Yeah.
Because you are the hewers of water. Totals of woods. Like Rev said, you step and fetch. Step and fetch. You were designed, or supposed to be designed, but not knowing that you were the procreator of all things. You made the first axe.
Yes.
Domesticate the world. Let's just see how smart you were. How long have y'all ever had bathrooms in Dallas?
Since
the early 40s. 30 years. That's been a long time, ain't it? Ain't long. I'm gonna show you something. I'm gonna shock your socks.
I'm gonna
shock your socks. I got a black man here this time. John G. Jackson. Man, God, and Civilization. We're going to the Evolution of Civilization in India, page 247. Second paragraph. 1396. I'll take that back. 396. That's my best. I got a pencil mark there. Okay. 396. Now you want to read it? Yeah. Come here. So green dress on? Are you awake yet? Come on. I know this is boring, but it's educational. What I have in parentheses, just come on down and, you know, and just stop. And come in and says, Russ, that's the last of it. 1396, you been reading that?
396, the first great civilization of India was established by the Dravidians in the Indus Valley. There, they built large cities, the principal ones being Mohenjo-Daro, Chandu-Daro, and Harappa. These cities were well constructed. Mohenjo-Daro was 2 square miles in area, which regularly laid out main and side streets.
Had main streets like downtown and side streets. Now, they had condos, didn't they?
Lined with attractive two-story brick houses.
What kind? What kind? Brick house.
Where's the condo? A two-story what? Brick. Y'all like, I'm gonna knock out her and get that condo. Bad color, 396 in Africa.
Bathrooms were a common.
Bathrooms.
Huh? And nature's life.
tree, we plant the ground, we do everything ungodly, actually, but yet we say we are what? God's people. Huh? God don't act like that. God people take care of God's business.
All right.
Hello. Hello. Let me rush along. I see y'all. See y'all getting a little patient. Amen. Let's go back and deal with creation. Thank you for coming. Leave your arm before you go. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I told you tonight that I brought you the real Bible. Many of you said, that nigga crazy. The word Bible comes with the word Bible. We would mean book. All these are Bibles.
All right.
But I brought you the authentic original, well, your King James copy, his copy, 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 came from. I see like a few more copies. I had to cut off right there because y'all got nervous. Now, if you think I'm wrong, let me go ahead and pull out this Bible right here, a Thompson Bible, chain reference Bible. In the back of it, they give you history of the Bible and its origin, the English Bible and its origin. I think you got one, Reverend. Have you, don't you have a Thompson chain reference Bible?
I think I have one.
Okay. In the back of it, it deals with the Bible and it gives you the breakdown of how the Bible came to be, the history of it and the makeup of it. Woo-hoo. Y'all tired?
Oh, no.
Okay. Okay, right here. Let's see. I'm going to be the next one. And yeah, right there. All right. Now, this gives you the origin and growth of the English Bible. What? Now, this is the original setup. Now, I want you to watch probably where the King James going to fall in. Each one of these Bibles take from another Bible or information, working your way up from the original manuscript, the most ancient what? Copies, ancient copies, ancient version. Note the word version. Not copy, but version. Vulgate, Wycliffe, Tyndale. Come on up, okay? Then you get up to the King James, because the King James was copied from Geneva and the Bishop Bible, but not from the original what? Manuscript. Hello. When you come down here, it says, these are the orders. The Codex Septuagint, Codex Vatican, Alexander, Codex Vatican. It goes over to the Septuagint, which was by Jerome. Come on. The Samaritan Pentateuch. Okay. It goes on. Vulgate by a black man, Jerome. Was it 400? Yeah.
400 AD.
And you start counting down. The Wycliffe Bible was 1320. Tyndale, you come on down. You find the King James, and you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's the 9th edition of the English translation. It's the late edition. That's about before the King James. But yet you love the King James. You love old King James. Well, that's what it said about old King James.
Don't start nothing.
Come on now.
Watch it.
What? Ain't condoning white writers. Hold my mic. Hold my mic. I'm going in here to page 22. 23. 22. Elvie, come in here. Bitch, I won't believe more people. May you believe this one.
Come on now.
Let's go here. I had to cut this a little short, but it talks about
okay, from the early manhood, James' policy was determined by his need to remain on good terms with the childless Elizabeth of England in order to ensure his claim as heir to the English throne.
He didn't want no children.
When his mother, who had been a prisoner in England for 20 years, was executed as the Fotheringay in 1587.
Look it up, about a whore.
he lodged only a formal protest. He realized that he was in no position to attack the English polity. And that it was
that's politics. That was Catholicism. That's right.
And that it would not be in its best interest to do so.
Okay.
In 1597 in Scotland, he published a trustee, Domino, or Ology, which gives a clear idea of his fear of the spirit world.
His fear, the word that is demonology. And so he was into demonology. His fear of the spirit world. Mm-hmm. He wrote a book, 1597. But he came right back and put your Bible together in 1604. Same man wrote a demon book, 1597, come right back and brought about a version of his other Bible, 1604 to 1611. Go on.
All right. And he feared the spirit world, and 2 years later he brought out a first small private edition of the Basilikon, Basilikon, Doron, described as his Majesty instructions to his dearest Sonny Henry, the Prince.
Sonny Henry, his lover. His lover.
His Prince.
Bible you ever seen, which is taken from the original writing, and I'm going to give you the author.